Last year, I did a review on a $100 telescope, and in this video, we're going to look at one that costs half as much. And it turns out, it's actually a pretty good little telescope. And if you keep watching, I'll show you how to make it even better. Welcome back to the Reflactor channel. The holidays came early here. Mrs. Reflactor knows that I'm a big fan of the Dobsonian style of telescope, and she found this little 3-inch Dobsonian for just $52. So this is called the Celestron Firstscope, and I've seen these go for as high as around $70 to $75, and I've seen them sell used for about $30. So keep your eyes open and you can find one of these cheap. I'll put an affiliate link down in the description box below. And of course, Celestron is not a sponsor. Yet. So let's go ahead and open up this box and see what a 3-inch Dobsonian looks like. Let's open the box. It is a 3-inch Dobsonian telescope. Of course, it's upside down. Very satisfying sound. So, okay, here it is. That's what it looks like. So it is a 3-inch diameter telescope and it has a focal length of 300 millimeters. All right, so let's open this up. Alrighty, we got some foam. That we got a box, something in it. We've got instructions, but we'll ignore those for now. And before I bring that out, let's look what's in this box. This supposedly comes with two eyepieces. There they are. Let's see what's in here. We've got a cleaning cloth. We've got two eyepieces. All right. So the first one is an H20mm, the H stands for Huygens. 20mm will give you a magnification factor of about 15, right? 300 divided by 20 is 15. H stands for Huygens. The Huygens style eyepieces are one of the oldest and simplest form of eyepieces, which also means they're one of the cheapest to make. Fun fact, this eyepiece design was actually invented a few years before Isaac Newton invented the reflector telescope. Now, the second eyepiece we have here is SR 4mm. The SR stands for symmetric Ramsden. It's also a very old cheap design. And at 4mm, that gives you a magnification of 75. I was hoping that this would come with at least one of the Plossly style of eyepieces. Those are kind of like the Honda of eyepieces. Plossly isn't a brand, it's actually a style. And it's been worked out and it works really, really well. And it's hard to make them poorly. They are reliable, they work well, and they are affordable. But I guess the Plossly aren't as affordable as a Huygens or a symmetric Ramsden. Now, let's get to the good part. Just reach in there and pull this guy out. There. It's in a bag. Pinch there. There's some foam. Alright, look at this. This is a tiny little Dobsonian. It's so small and so adorable. I think this might even be more adorable than the old Comatron CO62 that I reviewed a little while ago. Let's see. Oh, it's got really smooth azimuth turning and the elevation, the altitude up and down. It has a little knob right here that looks like, yeah, you can make it pretty tight or as loose as you want. Here's the little thing that says, don't look at the sun. We're not going to look at the sun. It appears to have the three Teflon bearings in there. It's a nice little azimuth bearing there. On the back there, it says Celestron 76mm, 3 inches roughly, and the focal length of about 300 millimeters. Oddly enough, that's the same length as the old Comatron CO62 as well. It's got a little dust cap. And look at that. It's a tiny little 3-inch mirror. That's pretty cool. It's a tiny little 3-inch mirror. See if you can see that. One thing it didn't come with, oddly enough, is a viewfinder. It has the two threaded nuts here for a viewfinder attaching like a red dot finder or something like that, but it didn't come with one. I guess the magnification is so low that you can kind of eyeball it. I don't know. It does have a rack and pinion focuser. No surprise there. Every introductory telescope you're going to find has a rack and pinion. Let's see how loose it is, though. It's kind of wiggly. I am very curious about the collimation on it. I know you can't ask for much. It was only $52, but let's pull the cap out. I have my collimation cap here, and I'm going to point it at the light and take a look. It's not too bad, actually. I mean, it's certainly centered. The mirror might be a little bit canted, but it looks like it's centered, so I think I can't fault them for that. Fun fact, you can actually buy an accessory kit for this style of telescope, and it comes with a viewfinder, and it comes with a moon filter and a couple of other eyepieces, which I assume are also cheap Huygens or Ramsden variants of eyepieces. Right away, you could probably upgrade this by buying a $20 Plossly eyepiece and maybe a Barlow, but we're going to go ahead and use the eyepieces that it came with. All right, we need to talk about spherical mirrors. You may have heard this term before. So all reflector telescopes have a mirror at the back, and it's shaped like a bowl. Now, the bowls come in two various shapes. The cheap mirrors have a spherical shape, and the higher priced mirrors have a parabola, or in the three-dimensional world, they call it a paraboloid shape. Now, rather than tell you why that's important, let me just show you. Let's go out and look at the moon. But first we need a viewfinder of some sort. Now, at first I thought about attaching a telrad to it, but you know, I couldn't really figure out where to mount the main part to it. I guess I could attach it with rubber bands. I might end up doing that. But if you don't have a $50 telrad, there's another trick you can use. You can just take a straw. It's fairly straight through there.
I can already see something. Let me try to focus on it. Oh yeah, now's a great time to push the like button. Thanks.
And we're going to take the straw. We're going to tape it here. This is a long straw, so it goes from the front flange to the back flange. I'm going to tape the front on. I'm going to tape the back on. And then when I take it outside, I'll be able to lift this tape up and move it left and right to fine tune it. So I will need to adjust it, but you know what? Let's go outside.
Let's aim it at the moon. I've got the 20 millimeter eyepiece in there. Notice how the moon begins to stretch whenever you move it towards the edge of the view.
It's actually surprisingly sharp. You can see some of the spherical aberrations on there, but I don't see much in the way of chromatic aberrations. Let's zoom in with the 4mm eyepiece. It gives a pretty good image with the 4mm eyepiece. It's not quite as sharp, obviously, as the 20mm. Now let's try an 8mm Plossly. That actually looks pretty good. It does run into the issue where you can either focus on the middle of the moon or the outer edges of the moon. That's just part of the spherical aberration.
Let's see if there's a cheap way to fix this spherical aberration.
Let's tell a story of two mirror cross-sections. The first is spherical. The second is parabolic. Forgive my art skills. This is supposed to be a circle, and this is supposed to be a parabola. So here's the problem. There's a common misconception that all of the light rays coming in from a spherical mirror focus at a common point. But that's actually just a myth. The reflections from a spherical mirror actually coalesce into this region right here, and it's more of a range of focus. So it will provide an image that is either sharp in the middle and blurry a little bit further away, or it'll be blurry in the middle and sharper a little bit farther away. You can adjust it by turning the focuser knob. This is an aberration that is caused by the spherical mirror. On the other hand, the higher end telescopes will use a parabolic mirror, and all of the light rays coming in do in fact focus at a common point. This mirror is a little more expensive to produce than this mirror. So let's talk about this spherical mirror. These are cheaper to produce. To counter the spherical aberrations that you run into, you can take all the extra time and effort to grind this mirror into a parabolic shape.
As it turns out, the spherical mirrors are used quite a bit in things like Schmidt-Cassegrain and Maksutov-Cassegrains. The trick that they use, though, is that they pre-treat the light upstream. In the case of a Schmidt-Cassegrain,
they have a corrector plate
that pre-treats the light and bends the light rays coming in so that when they do hit a spherical mirror, it will bounce off the secondary mirror and out the back and produce a very sharp image. And of course, the Maksutov-Cassegrain has a lenticular lens, big thick piece of glass. It does a very similar thing. And that's how they use a cheaper spherical mirror to still produce a nice image going out the back. By the way, this plate up here on a Schmidt-Cassegrain is not just a flat old piece of glass. It actually is an optically designed piece of glass that will pre-treat the light coming in. That's why you can't just go down to Home Depot and buy a piece of glass to replace that if you happen to break yours. What do we do about the spherical mirror that we have on our little Dobsonian? What can we do to fix that? One of the interesting things with the spherical mirror is you can actually minimize the effect of the spherical aberrations. And you do that basically by only using a smaller section of the telescope. And you basically are producing a telescope that has a much longer focal ratio. So if you only use this little section of the spherical mirror, it turns out that you get behavior that's very similar to a parabola. Now, of course, there's a limitation to this because you're going to run into the diameter of the mirror that it's blocking. Now, there is a way to actually force your telescope to use less of its mirror, and that is to produce a mask. Think of a washer upstream that is actually going to reduce the amount of light coming in, and it's going to basically use less of that spherical mirror. So that's why I have this box here. I do like Cheetos, but... we're going to make a mask. So this is the dust cover from the little daub. Let's trace it out. Let's put little tabs. Like that. And let's cut it out. Now, after doing some research online about what diameter to make the hole in the middle, it turns out that if you make it about 1.75 inches, that works pretty well with this particular telescope. So I have this hole saw right there, put that right in the middle, little circle. We'll cut that out too. Now, we'll tape this onto the front of the telescope. Let's go see if it improves the overall image. I can't get the whole moon in focus. I can either get the middle of the moon or the outer edges, and it still has kind of a hazy edge. Let's put our little mask on here. Okay, that's pretty fantastic. It's completely sharp, and the haze is completely gone from the edge. Once again, this mask is a little bit of magic. Wow.
I've had a chance to use this a few times now, and I have to say it's really starting to win me over. It's cheap, it's solid as a rock, and it is truly portable. It will fit in any size car. And as it turns out, you can get in several different designs. This one's pretty cool. It has a map of the moon on here with 10 different locations marked out, and they're listed here. So right away, you have things to look for while you're using this on the moon. There are, of course, a couple of letdowns on this. The first are the eyepieces. It really does ship with some junky eyepieces. You throw in a couple of Plossls, and it would greatly enhance the experience of using this telescope. It also has these threaded nuts right here for putting a viewfinder on here, but it doesn't come with a viewfinder. Sure does make it a little bit harder to use than it needs to be. And of course, it has the spherical mirror, which we've already discussed. Now, if you do add the eyepieces and the red dot finder, and you try to basically enhance the mirror, then you start to get into a higher end telescope. For example, the Orion Starblast 4.5-inch Dobsonian. This thing is really cool. I really like this. I've been using this for quite a while. It comes with a parabolic mirror, a red dot finder, and some really nice eyepieces. I've actually done a couple videos on this one. But of course, the Orion Starblast is a $200 range and up telescope, and this one's going to be in the $50 to $70 range. So who does this really appeal to? Well, it appeals to children mainly. In fact, if you have a child that has a budding interest in astronomy, this would be a great budget-friendly first telescope to get them. Just be sure to provide some supervision while they're using it so they don't try to point this at the sun. That will cause permanent blindness. Now, if you want to support the channel and you do feel like ordering one of these, I do have an affiliate link down in the description box. If you are interested in that Orion Starblast telescope that I showed just a bit ago, I actually have a couple of videos that I've already made about that one. But until then, thank you for watching, and clear skies, everybody.